Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
All right, let's come to order. This is the February 19th, 2018 meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. All the commissioners are present, and I would ask Vice Chair Lashley to please lead us in the invocation.
Sure, big late to. Let us all pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to honor you. We honor you through the way we live our lives, the way we treat each other. We ask you to be with us and guide us as we do the people's business tonight. Bless all that's here, our families. Bless this day and everything we do. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, before we get to the public speakers tonight, I've initiated a review of the public comment policy and the decorum of the audience rules for the Alamance County Board of Commissioners at the commencement of meetings, just to remind us about the expectations of one another so that things can flow smoothly and everyone will be on the sort of the same page. So, excuse me, each person desiring to speak during the public comment period shall have 3 minutes to make his or her remarks. There shall be no more than three speakers on any one topic per meeting. If we have speakers desiring to speak on the same topic and advocating the same position, that they would choose one person to speak for all. Speakers address the board from the lectern at the front of the room and begin their remarks by stating their name and address. There's 10 points to it. I'm not going to go over the whole thing tonight. It was adopted as revised by the Board of Commissioners in September of 2014, and it's available to be reviewed on the website of the county on the commissioner's page. Also adopted, I believe, at the beginning of 2017 were rules of procedure for the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, which includes a Section 7 decorum of the audience, which asks that audience members shall refrain from making unsolicited comments during the meeting. During speakers from the floor or debate by the board, audience members shall refrain from conduct which disrupts the proceeding, and audience members shall silence all cell phones and other electronic devices while attending the meeting. I'd like for the public to know that if you want to make comments, if you don't get to read your whole comments that you have prepared, you can submit them to the clerk for the board to be included with the minutes of the meeting. Or if you are just unable to make your comments at all, you're welcome to present those. Also, if there's any member of the public who wants to make comments and needs accommodation for a disability, if you let us know that ahead of time, we'll be glad to take care of that or assist you in that regard. Want to emphasize that I don't review that in anticipation of any speakers that we have tonight. That's not intended to be directed at any one person or directed toward anything that's happened in the past. It's just good. We have a lot of stuff going on this year with different issues that have come before the board. So we're reviewing those policies to help everyone, all those meetings, to proceed smoothly. So tonight we have one person signed up to speak. That's Malisi Peterson. Ms. Peterson, if you would like to come forward.
Good evening, everybody. And I appreciate the time you guys are giving me and everybody in the county. And it's kind of, I've come to this kind of long, hard road. You know, I came to you guys probably almost a year ago. And I was interested in doing something with the Knodel building. And, you know, you had a meeting, decided to vote on whether or not you would put a building up for an auction. You guys did that in good faith. I spent money getting the building inspected and was able to meet with or talk to Dr. Cronaldo, and he was kind of really excited about the collaboration for the building. Had another opportunity at the, Brian was gracious enough to invite me to the Graham Hopedale Corridor meeting. And I met Dr. Canodal there, the younger Canodal. And he said that when they donated that building to the county, it was in good shape. It was, you know, to be used for something good for the community. And I think our county, we weren't good stewards. And the building is pretty dilapidated. I spent money getting each one of you copies of the inspection. And those copies cost me about $250 just for the colored copies. Mr. Sutton, you asked to put it off for 30 days because you wanted to have an opportunity to go there and look at it. And I guess from my understanding, have you been there yet to see it?
I have, yes. Yeah. And I'll respond to your comments.
Yeah, so, you know, and I was a little taken back a little bit about your hostility toward me and your tone and about the amount that I had offered for the building. I work. I have a business. I pay taxes here. People that work for me pay taxes. And, you know, I give a lot to this community because the community has freely given back to me. You know, I came here, like I said, 4 children and $500. Alamance County's been very good to me. So with the work that I do as an agency, I do that from my heart. And so I had real high hopes about that building. The Canodals gave a lot to our community, and I felt like it had a place to be restored and to collaborate with other nonprofits and other businesses or whatever for the good of the community. And this thing has drugged on like, I mean, I'm tired, to be honest. I'm very tired. I understand that you guys have, you know, gotten some appraisals, and, you know, the county sits around with a lot of buildings that are being neglected and not being used properly. So my time is up, but I just want to say that I want to withdraw my bid tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Peterson. She's the only speaker we had to sign up. So commissioners' responses?
Yes, I'd like to respond. Number one, I'm one person up here, one of five. And I supported putting it off for 30 days, but I wasn't the instigator of that. I think if you go back and watch the tapes, you'll see that. My whole goal in this process, and yes, I did think $10,000 for a piece of property that just by itself is worth probably $200,000, just the lot itself, is not enough. I meant that. I still believe that. Now, again, I'm one of five people that sit up here. And yes, I did go to the building. I got up on the roof. I met Brian Haygood and went through the building. Yes, it's in rough shape. But there was nothing personal. I just, and it seems like you're kind of charging that it is, and I don't appreciate that. I don't think anything I have said publicly, nor much privately, would lead anyone to think that it was personal. I was for a review of how we disposed of that property that was fiscally sound and keep it in line with what the wishes were of the people that donated the building. But it was nothing personal at all. And so I feel like I'm being charged with something that's not accurate. Again, I'm one of five people that sat up here. County management recommended that we put it off. Our board had a consensus vote to do so. And I don't think Tim Sutton's heading was anywhere near that. And sorry you feel that way.
Anyone else? We have the Carnota building sale is an action item on our agenda tonight. And so I expect that at that time, Mr. Haygood will have some comments about the appraisal that was received and more information at that time.
Yes.
So, any more comments at this time?
I'll wait till the agenda item.
Okay, great. So, if everyone has had a chance to review the agenda, if we have a motion to approve it.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, gentlemen. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? And then we have the consent agenda with those items listed there. If everyone has had a chance to review those, we would have a motion to approve.
Make a motion. We approve. Yeah.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? All right. So for now we move on to the opioid litigation update with Mr. Albright. Attorney Albright, I understand that we have some law firms here to present to the board. Is that correct?
We do, and as you may recall, we issued a request for information, and we had two other law firms respond to that. Paper firm is represented here, and Kruger Dixon firm. And I've handed out booklets from both.
And do we have another one here to address the board?
George Daniels.
And the Baron and Bud firm, and if you remember, we've already presented twice and submitted
right.
substantial information to the board, having been here on the 16th, and then I think again I was here on February the 5th.
Right, that's correct.
Great. So we're going to have a presentation from you, and
we
then
are.
From each of those attorney firms.
Very
firms.
Short presentation from me, and 10 minutes from each of the firms.
Great, thank you.
And what you have before you is a resolution to pursue legal action against manufacturers and distributors of opioids. And what I have done is met with the health director and the DSS director and the sheriff and EMS to put together this resolution that has some facts that are unique to Alamance County in this regard. And this will provide the basis for hiring the firms to pursue legal action. I didn't want to get into the specific complaint or what theories these firms would put forward. So I feel like this is the best way to handle this part of it, get the resolution out there. Alamance County has had some negative effects from this crisis, as set forth in the resolution. And if you have any questions about it, I'll take them. And if not, I suggest maybe we just go ahead and get on to the presentations from the law firms.
Okay, great. Let's hear first from the Kruger Dickinson law firm, please.
Madam Chairman, I hear comments that people in the audience can't hear the person speaking at the podium, so
all right.
Check to see if that mic's on.
I have a very loud voice, but can folks hear me in the back? No?
Yep.
Okay, great. I will.
Thank you for bringing that to our attention.
I've almost never been told that I can't be heard, so hopefully everyone can hear me. I'm Erin Dickinson. I'm one of the owners of the Kruger Dickinson Law Firm. With me tonight is my partner, Krista Bache, and Janet Ward Black, who is one of the preeminent trial lawyers in North Carolina. We handed out a set of materials. I'm sure that you've gotten materials, more materials than you'll ever want to look at in this regard. There are many firms looking at this issue, but I want to take my time to start, and then I want to turn it over to both of these ladies so you also can hear from them. Just I think it's important to hear from all of the folks on the team in some respect. I want to talk about our team, and in your materials you'll get a whole lot of background on our team. It is essentially three firms, which you'll see on the front cover of the materials: my firm, Kruger Dickinson, the Simmons Hanley Conroy firm, and a firm called Von Brazen and Roper, who has represented county governments for over 30 years, and I work with on a regular basis when I have any issue that affects counties that comes to my attention. So those three firms join together. In the course of that, we have Janet Ward Black, who will be our local counsel in North Carolina. At the end of our presentation, I want Janet to actually speak in her own words about her trial experience in North Carolina. Obviously, she can say it better than I can. But I want to start with our team. We were essentially got involved in this process with North Carolina because our three firms had presented at a national conference on opioid litigation over a year ago. These three firms had come together in a way that we now represent over 200 counties around the United States, and we were asked to come and present to county executive directors of the associations for various states. Through that, we were then invited back to North Carolina to come and speak to the county attorneys in North Carolina. So we did that this past fall. We made a presentation, Paul Hanley and I, to all the county attorneys. And now we're here because you're considering this really important piece of litigation. And I will say, if you take nothing else away from my comments, please consider bringing the litigation, whether it's with us or somebody else. It's really important. I have ended up at the forefront of the national litigation, and so have my co-counsel. I want to talk for a minute about that. When I got into representing counties, the first thing I did was, as many of you might do, find the person who knows the most about this that I might want to partner with on these cases. That person is Paul Hanley. Paul's not here. He did speak to all the county attorneys because he is the lead counsel on the nationwide litigation. We have had to divide and conquer. It is every day almost we are bringing a new case on behalf of counties because this litigation is going at a speed of light. But I want to talk a little bit about Paul, and he would let me do this if I was here because he couldn't stand to brag about himself and his experience, but I will. Paul Hanley is the person in the United States that knows the most about this subject, bar none. I encourage you to Google him. I encourage you to look around and vet that statement. When I was looking at a firm that I was going to partner with for the counties that were asking me to represent them, I vetted who might know the most about this and came across Paul's experience. Paul's firm, over 15 years ago, sued these defendants, Purdue Pharma in particular, over folks that were dying as a result of the opioid crisis. So 5,000 individuals hired his firm to sue these companies. And as a result of that work, the U.S. Department of Justice subpoenaed Paul's work product and indicted several of the executives and fined the company $632 million. That's what the U.S. Department of Justice thought of the work that Paul had done. Paul had settled his cases and moved on, thinking that was sort of the end of it, recovery for the families, and let's move on. Fast forward to today, and the epidemic happened. And it has been creeping up since that time period in 2007 when the Department of Justice indicted these folks and fined the companies. Counties began to ask lawyers like me and Paul to represent them. That team came together to start representing counties. And our team not only has Paul, who is the expert on this subject, our team has lawyers who have represented counties. Krista can talk for a minute about her background, but she has litigated defending counties in courtrooms repeatedly. We have a guy named Andy Phillips, who is at the firm of Von Breezen and Roper, who has represented counties as their general counsel around the United States. So that team came together for a substantive reason. As this process went along, and as you've probably heard from the other folks that have talked to you, the nationwide litigation has come together in one location, in Cleveland, Ohio. All federal court cases will go to this one location. So your cases in North Carolina, even though they will be filed in North Carolina, will not remain in North Carolina for very long. I think you've probably been told that. So what happens? There will be a team of lawyers who you probably also heard a little bit about leading this litigation. I sit on that executive committee of 25 lawyers. Paul Hanley sits as one of the three co-lead counsel. So you are well represented in that group. I will say that Paul's experience has been recognized even within that group as really a leader. When the defendants want to reach out to our side, lots of times they reach out to Paul. When the judge needs to reach out to our side, they also reach out to Paul. There are special masters in the case that also reach out to the lead counsel. So a very important piece, and for you to be well represented, is to have someone in that group. I sit on the executive committee. We are doing the work of this country's litigation in this location. I'm going to let Janet talk about it in a minute. But if that litigation comes back to North Carolina, you will need a really good trial lawyer in federal court. And she's going to address that in just a minute, because Janet is, there is no equal. She is the best. And I can say that. She might not. So that piece is also there on this team. It is an interesting time to be in this federal court that has taken on all these cases. You probably heard a little bit about it in earlier presentations. The judge in this case is really interested in resolving this issue. And we've put in the materials, I think it's worth a read, the transcript from the first hearing. He came out and said, I am not going to listen to lawyers fight while people are dying around the United States. I want to resolve this issue, and I want to resolve it in 2018. That is a very ambitious goal, I will tell you, but it is a huge step in terms of a court almost turning the process on its head, and it's a really good step for counties who are bleeding money and who are hurting. So we are really encouraged by being in federal court in this case. A lot of times, as a plaintiff's lawyer, I will tell you, I would stand up here and say, stay in your hometown, stay in your state court. This is a bit different. We have a judge who understands and appreciates the problem and has done everything he can to move that process forward. The plaintiff's committee got together and elected a group of lawyers to go and participate in the ongoing settlement negotiations that are occurring. Our representative is Paul. He's doing that as we speak. The rest of us are getting ready for trial. That's what we do. And so this is moving with a mock speed, and I think that's why you're hearing from so many folks around the country. But we really, really want you, this is not a political issue, but it is a very serious issue, and we hope that you take time to kind of look through, and we've put a lot of things in your materials about why, you know, select us. We've been asked, and I know there are lots of firms that have talked to you, and a few more tonight, to compare those folks. I will tell you, you probably are being approached, and the ones I know are all good lawyers. To me, if I had to say, you know, why us? Every single other person in the United States that are doing these cases are essentially following behind the person that started it. So that really is something to be considered. I love the lawyers that are on this team with me. I'm not going to stand up and highlight differences with other legal teams. One, because I think most of them are very stark but strategic. If you all are interested in hearing about that in a closed session, I think that would be much more the appropriate forum in terms of legal strategy differences. There are many between the teams, but I don't think it serves the county to have lawyers hashing them out in an open forum. I just don't think that's the best way to go, and I'll leave it at that for now. I'd like Krista to address just a few practical questions that folks typically have. What is this going to cost? How much time? What does your group do if they're going to come in here and figure out this problem in my county? We've answered those for the 200 and some counties. We have counties that are very far down the road in developing what their damages look like, and we really can bring that team and that experience right into the county. You will see an awful lot of the two of us if that happens. Krista and I are really running that on the ground for each of our counties. I truly believe that we do not get better results unless we are physically here in your county doing that. So unfortunately, you'll see a lot more of us if you choose to hire our team. But I'm going to turn it over.
May I ask you a question before you leave?
Of course.
You referred to this, and I thought you might have the immediate answer. What administration and Justice Department did Mr. Hamby do his case under?
So these were private litigation for 5,000 individuals who had died as a result of overdosing. And Paul had brought those on behalf of 5,000 people. Eventually, Purdue Pharma had enough and settled those cases for a substantial amount of money for the families. As soon as the U.S. Department of Justice got wind of that, they came and asked Paul if he would submit his information. He said, of course, but subpoena me, and they did, and that was the resulting most of that information was what led to this massive fine and the convictions. I will tell you, we now know companies went on business as usual, just in a little bit different way, and did the same things they were doing essentially before.
My question is, which Justice Department was it?
United States Department of Justice in D.C.
What administration?
Oh, I'm sorry, 2007, so it was under Obama.
Okay, and Holder.
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
All right.
Yes. Sorry, I misunderstood your question.
I'll make it real clear. All right.
I was not following that. But yes, that is who it was.
I like her odds better now, so no offense.
You got it. All right, we'll let Ms. Grace talk
for a minute. Hi, I'm Krista. Good evening. In your materials tonight, you also have a copy of our Mecklenburg County complaint that we filed a couple weeks ago. And in addition, we will be filing a complaint for Cleveland County. The Speaker of the House, Tim Moore, the county attorney there, made the recommendation to hire our firms. and we have been hired by their county to proceed with litigation against the manufacturers and the distributors. The reason I wanted to talk to you tonight is I have talked personally to over 100 counties in the past year, and more often than not, the number one question I get from each county I talk to, whether that's a board member, a county attorney, or a department head, is tell me what my role is going to be in this litigation. Explain to me what the county is going to have to do. Because obviously, we are bearing the cost of this litigation. Every firm you talk to is going to do this on a contingency fee, but the county is going to have a role. You are going to have man hours that you're going to have to contribute to the development of the case. And I will tell you very honestly, that has changed in the past year as a result of the way Judge Polster has addressed this case. When we first started working on these cases, we started gathering information with our third-party vendor, ILS, where we came in and we met with the department heads and we talked about the opioid-related information in each department, and we put together a very detailed document collection plan to gather that information, and we did that. And we have counties in New York that are still doing that, because in New York, they are actively pursuing discovery, and that is also being headed up by Paul Hanley, who is the lead counsel of our team. We are an extension of Paul, and that information that is being gathered from both the defendants and the plaintiffs is gonna benefit the members of our team. In the MDL, there is no discovery. No discovery is going on. However, the judge has ordered settlement discussions. So as part of that, our team, which has had an active role in those discussions, is needing to still gather damage-related information. So although we are not doing the huge document collection gathering that is going on in other counties where active discovery is being pursued, we are doing very high-level damage analysis and damage collection, because we need that information if these cases are going to be resolving. And that is something that I am doing on a daily basis with the counties that I am working with, where we are going through the information that the counties have with the department heads, and we are trying to get a handle on exactly how this epidemic is impacting not only the individual counties, but also what is the national picture of what this is going to look like. If this is something that we're going to be able to resolve in 2018, which Judge Polster has made very clear he wants to do, we have to have people that are working on these cases. And we are the legal team that's doing that, because we are the legal team that's working with Paul Hanley. So, and with that, sorry I spoke so fast, I'm from the Midwest. I did go to school in the South, here in North Carolina, so I'm very happy to be here.
So I will take 30
Don't stay with school, because they might not like your school.
I was a Tar Heel.
Didn't leave you much time, did she?
That's okay. All I was going to say, since I think they've said it very well, is I'm from Greensboro.
Ms. Black, may I ask, can y'all hear her?
Not yet.
Okay. My name is Janet Ward Black, and I'm from Greensboro, so I'm just down the street. This is a little different. This litigation is all in federal court. That's what we're talking about. Most lawyers hate federal court. They don't want to file. They want to file across the street. They want to be with local judges. That is not the case in this instance. Since I was a state court prosecutor, after that, for the last 25 years, I've represented North Carolinians in drug, pharmaceutical, and asbestos litigation in this state in the federal courts. I have filed hundreds of lawsuits and am fairly well adept at being able to work in that arena. It is not one where you show up at the courthouse and you argue with your neighbor in front of the judge who stands for election. These are judges who are appointed for life. It is almost invariably done on the papers and nothing else, and it is a very different day. So one of the reasons that I believe that I was selected was because one of my background here in North Carolina and just my familiarity with federal court, which a lot of lawyers just don't like.
That is a well put, Shannon. Well, we appreciate our time. I think we are nearly at the end of it, if not a little bit over, but we really do appreciate the time. To the extent any folks have any questions, it's a lot to absorb in 10 minutes. I answer these questions probably almost 24 hours a day, which is very sad, a statement about my personal life, but we are willing to take them by email, by phone call, and certainly through the county attorney, who we've had a lot of interaction with over these issues. So feel free to ask them. Feel if you want to dive deeper into the strategy differences or anything else, we are happy to answer those in a close situation. Thank you.
Well, I think it's appropriate if commissioners have any questions for you at this time that they want to raise.
Great.
To see if anybody has a question for this group.
I know who you are. Aren't you in Wendover?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I know who your office is.
Well, I have one question, I guess, maybe to our attorney. We've been discussing this for month and a half. Where you get girls been?
Before, what?
Where have we been?
Yeah, like every day. That's where I've been.
Okay.
And we sent that request for information out, and they responded.
Within an hour.
Yes. And after you hear the presentation, if you proceed to adopt the resolution I presented, then we can discuss who we want to hire.
Representative at that point.
We'll have to have a closed session meeting for that, but that'll give you time to digest what you've got, ask any questions by email to me, and I can forward them on to you.
Well, that helps clarify, because we're sitting with a resolution, hopefully, to move forward on
well,
tonight.
Well, that's just to give me the authority
to
at
do
some
something.
Time to make a arrangement.
Okay.
We want to, as she said, as Aaron said, there is some speed to this case.
Right. And you know, apologize for not being before you all, and I understand folks have been, we have had several presentations to the county attorneys. We really felt and have felt across the country, mainly because we represent counties, we're very sensitive to this, that we did not want to communicate with board members in any way, shape, or form outside of this process. So we waited really for this process and the RFP to come out, and that's really why we're here today. So
Very good.
One thing that I heard from you I hadn't heard before is that you're working on a contingency basis.
Yes.
Is that true for all of the firms that are involved in this?
That is true. All of the firms are generally working on the same type of a basis. There may be little nuances here and there. I haven't reviewed everyone's contract, but our contingency fee arrangement that we've done with now the over 200 counties is a 25% of the recovery if there is one. Obviously, if there is no recovery, we take the risk that we have paid for all the costs, which we do. We advance the costs, and we get nothing. That's our risk. But the reason that that's so important is because if your lawyers are willing to take this kind of cost on, they must believe in your case. And so it is definitely something you can point to as we've really vetted this case, I guess, is what I would say about that.
And the reason I was surprised is that our Commissioners Association had talked about a fair way of splitting the legal fees associated. But I guess it's through that 25% of the recovery.
Yes. And I think every firm that you'll encounter that does what we do operates on that basis. That's a fairly standard.
So everybody is operating on pretty much the same.
I think that's right. Certain folks around the country, but I don't think you guys have that here, have been sort of, you know, outbidding each other and things like that. It sounds like you have a very good and classy group of lawyers and a good, you know, basis for their legal fees. In this state, I don't think you're going to run into that. So I think you're in a good spot.
And so the 100 counties, too, have engaged your firm, is that right?
Yes. So to date, we have been engaged by Mecklenburg County and Cleveland County. I will say that we're presenting to a whole number of boards in the next few days, but those are undetermined at this time. So,
okay.
And those counties are across the country, not...
She was just speaking about North Carolina. We represent about 200, and I think it was 205 at last count. And some very large counties of over, we represent the city of, Paul represents the city of New York, Cook County, some really large counties around the United States. We also have been really involved in a grassroots effort in some states to really get their counties together to bring a force to bear. That is very important. At some point, there will be a discussion between the states and the counties, and you better be well organized when you're going to have that discussion. And we've been really deep into that. For example, in several states, 90% of the counties just hired our team for that reason. So there would be a lot of continuity. But we certainly work with the other folks very, very closely and intend to do so. All of us sit on this one committee together, so we have every incentive to do that in these cases. And I have no doubt that will happen. So.
Any further questions?
Okay, thank you so much. Answer some questions that we really didn't know the answer.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
All right, our next firm to present is the Painter Law Firm. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Painter Law Firm.
Painter.
And I'm Stuart Painter, and I'm with my colleague Celeste Boyd. And I think we had a PowerPoint. If we can pull it up, but if not, it's a. There we go. If not, it's not a big deal.
Yeah, he's working on it.
Okay, perfect.
And Mr. Painter, I'll let you know that for the preceding firm, and the commissioners asked questions during your presentation. I got my eye on the time. And so if somebody asks you questions, don't worry that
Okay.
You're going to get docked on your time for that. Right. So we'll add to it to accommodate that.
Excellent. Well, we're here obviously under sad, tragic circumstances. There has been an epidemic of national proportions. And it's even more tragic because it's one that was man-made and entirely avoidable in some sense. It was pharmaceutical companies pushing as safe and effective these powerful narcotic drugs, safe, effective, and as non-addictive these powerful narcotics, which certainly were none of those things. So I'd like to briefly take you through our proposal, talk about our qualifications, and then discuss about some of the, at a very high level, some of the strategic decisions that you will have to make as a county. Outside of the context of an attorney-client relationship, obviously I don't want to get into a lot of specifics, but just the types of decisions that you'll have to make for litigation of this complexity. Our main advantage is we are a local firm. We're right down the street in Hillsborough, North Carolina, but we have a national reputation and we have a national practice. Complex litigation is what we do. It's basically all we do. We're federal court attorneys. Those are our cases. All our cases, almost all our cases, involve complex issues of law, multiple defendants, multiple large corporate defendants. We routinely have cases with multiple classes of plaintiffs suing multiple defendants. And we, in many cases, have litigation that involves actions in different federal courts proceeding simultaneously in federal courts and also in state court at the same time. Very complex stuff. And I can only do that with my colleagues such as Celeste and other attorneys who are very qualified, top law schools. A lot of them worked at big defense firms like myself. I worked at Sullivan and Cromwell, which is a large New York firm in the antitrust division representing Microsoft. Before I went and turned to a plaintiff side practice in North Carolina. And last but not least, we're well capitalized and we have the ability to handle the expenses, any expenses that would be incurred as a result of the litigation. The county, these would all be advanced on behalf of the county. These would include trial expenses, travel expenses for attorneys, and of course expert expenses, which can be quite large, hundreds of thousands of dollars in a case of this size and complexity. Just a very high-level view of some of the strategic decisions that you will have to make in this litigation. First, and obviously, what types of claims you're going to bring. There's a menu of claims, federal claims, which guarantee you're in federal court. There are also state claims you could bring. In making that decision, obviously one thing you want to think about is the potential for attorney fees, a potential for fee shifting. There is the potential for fees to be shifted against the county, and that is something that you will want to carefully consider in the context of an attorney-client relationship with whoever you hire. Damages, again, this was touched on by my colleague, Erin, who was in her presentation. It is important to begin work on that soon. Both for purposes, even if there's settlement discussions, you're flying blind if you don't have your damages theories, if you haven't gathered the information, if you don't have the right experts lined up. The last one I have there is the forum. That's going to be a very important decision for you to make. I wouldn't want to advise you in this context one way or the other, but there is this federal, it's called a multi-district litigation proceeding, which we're very familiar with them. We've done those many times in Ohio. But there's the option potentially to stay in state court. There are ways that can potentially be done, and that's a key strategic decision for you to make, and there are certainly advantages and disadvantages to either one. And finally, coordination with the Attorney General, our Attorney General here. That's going to be important. The Attorney General's investigating these claims has brought, as you guys probably know, one case already against a defendant in Wake County. And it's key to coordinate both as a practical matter, because you're going to want to coordinate discovery, and also as a legal matter. I mean, you're not going to want to end up in a situation where the defendant or defendants are claiming that your claims are released, the county's claims are released, as a result of actions taken by the North Carolina Attorney General. And so that's a key thing to keep in mind. And that'll be a key decision that you will make as you move forward with the litigation. Our proposal, as requested by the county, is a contingency litigation. We would not be charging any fees, and we would be advancing all costs. Those costs would be recouped out of any recovery, but if there was no recovery, we would essentially write off those costs. In terms of the contingency fee, certainly 25% is reasonable. It may be that you want to stage that fee in some circumstances. That's something that's sometimes done, where you have a lower fee if it settles before trial, and maybe a higher fee if there is extensive discovery, and then a higher fee if it actually goes to trial. And that's something you may want to seriously consider. You don't necessarily want to be paying a whole contingency if it's going to settle in 6 months. I have here, in terms of the structure, we are open to, we can handle the case ourselves. I mean, we handle complex litigation like this. As I said, this is what we do. We're also happy to work with a co-counsel of the county's choosing. We're also happy to work with the council to structure a team that we think complements what we would do for the county. And we know many of the firms that are involved. And finally, as part of our proposal, one of the things we can offer is reinvestment back in the county. I think we noted that one of the things we can do, and this is just because it's a passion of mine, is reinvest part of our fee back in the county. It's kind of a sort of passion project. I do a lot of historic rehabilitation of buildings. I heard you were discussing one, obviously, earlier in this meeting. And so that's something we can offer that I think is unique because we are a local firm, albeit with national experience. And so I think that you have our materials, and I don't want to duplicate things that are already in the written materials before you. But if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
I am curious. I could have asked you, but I'll ask one per group. Our Justice Department now, under this administration and Sessoms and so forth, have they expressed, I should know this, but don't, have they expressed much opinion on this? I'm sure the White House has come out blasting this scenario. What has our Justice Department said, basically?
Well, I think typically those investigations will be done out of the public eye. I mean, the DOJ, I have friends who work there, and I've had many friends who work there. I'm a highly professional organization, and I think that they're going to be doing their job. In terms of comments from the administration, I'm sure there have been some, and there's certainly been some on the opioid epidemic generally. In terms of specific to litigation by government entities, I don't know if there have been commentary.
I don't think they've been.
I can
told.
Answer. Do you guys want meeting? Just
sorry,
quickly.
Just curious.
So the judge has brought together what he views as all stakeholders, including the federal government, the AGs, and all of the lawyers representing the counties in the United States. And his vision is that there, if there is a resolution, all of those stakeholders will actually have a participation in it. Now, the federal government, at the federal government level, one thing, if you read the judge's transcript, he said, look, a lot of people are saying a lot of things about how to fix the problem, but we haven't seen anybody fixing it.
Mm-hmm.
And so his view is, if I can help pull some of those folks into court, that all of the stakeholders, states, federal, and us, will be involved in that resolution because it's too big of a problem. Everybody is, at least at this point, saying that they will participate in that problem. I mean, the White House has done a number of studies on the problem and abatement and things, but I also want Janet to talk about it in a minute. She's actually going to be there next week.
Actually, I'm leaving Wednesday. I've been invited to the White House to meet with the new drug czar. You may have known, has been with the chief of staff in the White House. He started his job last Monday. I'm in relationship with Caleb Christian Radio Network, and they have invited 8 of us to be a delegation from Caleb to meet with the drug czar on Thursday morning for a 3-hour conference. So I can tell you, at least based on that limited information, that the administration is very interested in the problem. They've invited some very interesting people, one of whom is Daryl Strawberry, that you may recall, the Major League Baseball player, who now actually is working in drug rehabilitation in a very effective way. So it's people like that that they've invited to the White House to get their ideas about things that might be of value.
don't mean to ride on your time.
No worries. So other questions that you all have?
I have one question.
Sure.
Not about your firm, but about the, I guess, the damages. So I noticed on our resolution, Clyde, that we, and you all speak to, the issue of people overdosing on prescription drugs, but there's also the issue of people getting addicted with prescription drugs, and when they're no longer available, they're turning to street drugs, heroin, and especially heroin with fentanyl, and then they die from that.
Absolutely.
So that would be included in the damages, I guess, the cost associated with those.
Absolutely.
Deaths, not just
yeah.
the prescription. Okay.
Yeah, because I think that's well documented scientific progression that people go through from the prescription drugs, which tend to be more expensive even when you're obtaining them illegally, to heroin and other drugs. And so that would be part of the damages model, increased law enforcement costs, increased costs for foster care, all those things.
Thank you.
And have any of the other counties in North Carolina retained your firm?
We have not been retained by any other county.
Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you.
That's
anyone
good.
Else?
Good.
Yeah. All right, thank you, Mr. Painter. Great. We have finally Mr. Daniel with the Daniel Law Firm and his co-counsel. Before we get started, I think I've been remiss in not stating publicly that I used to work for Mr. Daniel. It's been 2.5 years since I did. That was part-time. And I have no interest in his firm now. I don't work for them. I don't have any plans to work for them. I don't have any conflicts with voting on this matter. I have a duty to vote under North Carolina state law, but I thought that, I think that most people in the county who know me know I work for Mr. Daniels, so I guess that's why I haven't mentioned it before, but I thought that at this point that I should make that statement.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
So, go ahead, please.
Even if you abstained, it would be a yes vote. Is
that's
that
right.
right. I believe that's right.
On the resolution.
Well,
that's what we're deciding.
Chair and I discussed this, and unless she is receiving direct financial benefit from it, which she is not, she needs to vote on it.
Yeah. Well, I'm not really charging that at all.
I understand.
Rhetorically, I was just saying, even if she abstained, it would be a yes vote. Is that not correct, though, while we're here?
If it passes,
I think it is.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Well, I'm not sure. But if somebody refuses to vote, then it's a yes. But if they abstain because they don't have, because they have a financial interest
yeah.
in it, then I think it just doesn't count.
I think Ann Vaughn voted. She did vote one night. Okay.
All right.
We don't need to go back there.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Chairperson. I've come before you. This is, I think, my third time now, and happy to be here. It started 4 months ago when we had a meeting, a pre-meeting with Ryan and Clyde, and had other members of my team, Mr. Paul. Well, first of all, my son Jake, and Mr. Paul Coates of Pinto Coates, also out of Greensboro, and we started this to bring when we were looking at Alamance County and looking at all the data, we wanted to go straight to where we should go, and that would be to the county attorney and the county manager. After that, we presented. Applied with packages, resolutions, fee agreements changed over time. Everyone is a 25% contingency, and I want to hand to you, because at the time we were meeting at that time in 2017, if I may, in 2000, there are approximately 25 counties that have now signed up,
thanks,
either a resolution or signed with a firm to represent, and half of those signed up before I got to come before you January the 16th, and the other half has been moving fairly quickly, as has been said, they have signed up since then. And of that, if the team that we're with is a 5 national law firm, Barron & Bud, out of Dallas, Texas, Green Ketchup, out of West Virginia, Hill Peterson out of West Virginia, 11 Papatino out of Florida, and McHugh Fuller, who Amy is a member of. Amy Kazon. Now, I want you to know that of all the 25, as you've heard, one tonight has signed on with Hanley. The other 24 have signed on with the Baron and Bud Fund, who we are part of. And she will tell you exactly the position that they hold, these national firms hold, in the management of this litigation. And even though you haven't seen all these firms around, you've seen us, and you've seen us for the last 4 months.
Good evening. My name is Amy Kazon, and I'm from Tampa, Florida. But my law firm is actually based out of Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And I'm a trial lawyer as well, and because of that, I'm admitted in a number of different states. I tease with my husband that I've got the ACC and SEC covered, and I'm working on the Big Ten. But the way I got involved with this litigation started in West Virginia because of some trial work that I was doing up there, and I got to be good friends with another trial lawyer there named Paul Farrell. And Paul Farrell's from Huntington, West Virginia. And the only reason I bring that up is because it becomes important in sort of the story. As you probably know, sort of the epicenter of this epidemic is right there in that tri-state, the Ohio, Kentucky, West Virginia, right there where the river runs through. And he lives right there on the edge, right in Cabell County, where Marshall University is. Well, he started seeing what was happening in his city, and he couldn't figure out why, because the manufacturers had been sued. They'd been sued years before for their false advertising and saying that it wasn't addictive, but the problem was getting worse, not better. So the Attorney General there in West Virginia sued not only the manufacturers, but the wholesale distributors, the middlemen. All they do is basically take it from the manufacturer down to the pharmacy. And he sued them, alleging that they were not following the Controlled Substance Act. Because to have a DEA license, they had, under the law, a federal law, an obligation that if they saw suspicious orders of unusual size or frequency or a pattern that was out of the ordinary, they had to do three things. They had to stop the shipment, they had to notify the DEA, and they had to do their own investigation. And the way we figured out what was going on is because in that lawsuit by the Attorney General, the data that is kept by the DEA, it's called the ARCOS data, and it tracks every milligram of opioids. The ARCOS data, which is held by the DEA and nobody gets to see it, was released, and somebody from the Charleston Gazette got a hold of it. For 5 years straight, the wholesale distributors into a town of 100,000 people sent 6.4 million pills a year. So no wonder we can't arrest our way out of this problem. We're flooded. So our team, and it was put together mainly because when you looked at the wholesale distributors, these aren't Fortune 500 companies, these are Fortune 25 companies. So Paul Farrell knew he couldn't handle it on his own. He had done some work with some national law firms, Barron and Budd and Levin Papantonio. We had done trial work with him there in West Virginia and some other states, and so he said, we can't do this on our own, do you want to join forces? And we did. And that's how we came together. And our concentration is a little bit different than some of the other teams. Our concentration has been on those wholesale distributors from the beginning. We do bring in the manufacturers, and we bring them in on a RICO count because they were sharing information. And they knew just as much as the distributors did, and they were swapping information to keep our communities flooded. So those are some of our legal theories that are a little bit different than some other teams have. But again, it would be your case, and it would be your decision as to the legal theories. The other thing I think that sets us apart a little bit, so there's two ways to kind of look at the damages, and I know you guys were interested in sort of the damage model. And the way I look at it is there's the damages that have already happened. the increases in the foster care system, the treatment centers, the hospital costs, the EMS costs, all those are sort of damages that have happened in the past. And that would come in under like a negligence count. You were negligent, you caused all this damage to the county, we want to recoup our money. But it's not just that. We also bring a public nuisance cause of action because we want to look prospectively. How, just because we turn the floodgates off, right, and maybe we can get this whole pelt thing under control, the town still has to be cleaned up. Now that the floodwaters are back where they belong, we still have a mess on our hands. And so our damage model is threefold. Number one, education. And I mean education down to an elementary school level where the children are taught age appropriately that the pills in mommy and daddy's medicine cabinet are just as dangerous as putting a needle in your arm. And that's where it'll probably lead. Number two, law enforcement. You've talked a little bit about the heroin issue, and I think the statistics are like 80% of heroin users start by prescription drug, and that's the tail end of the epidemic. What happens is when the pills aren't as available anymore, or when they're too expensive, then heroin comes in because you've got addicts. And so we're going to need law enforcement to stop what's coming in from Mexico and from China and to get that under control. And then finally, the treatment. And treatment not just for the addicts themselves, but these days, I think the statistic now is I know in Huntington, West Virginia, 25% of the babies that are born there have neonatal abstinence syndrome. And we don't even know what the damages that those kids are going to continue to suffer, and developmental problems, and behavioral problems. We just don't know the answer to it yet. Now, we have got epidemiologists on board. We've got three DEA diversion experts. They're former DEA agents. I don't know if anybody saw the 60 Minutes episode, but it's...
I've seen that.
Okay.
Yeah.
A lot of the men and one woman who were DEA agents are working with our consortium. And that is sort of, I believe, what sets us apart. We were actually, it was our consortium that filed for the multi-district litigation. We were the ones that went to the federal court and said, hey, we need to get this consolidated. And that's how it ended up in Cleveland. We also are one of the co-leads, along with Mr. Hanley. Mr. Farrell's one of the co-leads, and we have many positions. I think our consortium as a whole has more than anyone, I believe, on the executive committee. We also represent about 250 counties across the nation, and I think the number's up to 24 here. Might be interesting for the consideration of the board. Rockingham, Guilford, Randolph, Caswell, Person, and Orange. We represent. And the only reason I mention it is it seems reasonable to me that a treatment center could be used by a number of different areas. As opposed to one county shouldering all that particular, you know, if it would be convenient. So I think cost effectiveness, some of the questions that the county attorney had to do with perhaps a capping of fees, and we have done that when asked by counties, so that no matter what the costs are, there's a cap on the percentage that comes to us. I think the cost effectiveness, because of the number of counties we represent, again, one county isn't going to shoulder a $50,000 expert. All that would be used on to the benefit of all, and so it would be a common benefit fund. And I think I've hit the high points. So if there are any questions, I'm happy to respond.
I'm curious about it. I didn't, unless I missed it, and I probably did miss it. I didn't realize that we had all these presentations from firms and have to choose from one for one. Were the majority of for instance, George or
or even maybe you, or you. Were the majority of these presentations multifaceted? I mean, did you have different firms coming in for all of them, or did one firm go into, were there a lot of one firm presentations, or what?
Are you talking about the County Attorneys Association?
Well, for what we're doing here tonight, we got three firms in here.
Well,
right?
What has happened across the board from Rockingham, Surrey, and Stokes and Yadkin, there may very well have been interest shown by the other firms, but I think by being out there early and dealing with the county commissioners and with the information that was coming from your county attorneys and County Commissioners Association, they joined in.
Okay.
And well, I think the same thing too, Commissioner Sutton, happened. Forsyth County and Guilford had just signed on with Barron and Budd. And they and just like Alamance, Guilford and Forsyth had a considerable number of questions, so it was continuing to go back to the well, go back to the drawing board to get the resolution tweaked in the contract.
Okay, I understand that. What I'm asking is, were there a lot of one firm presentations with
in those counties,
yeah,
decided
right
on the resolution?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to get.
Yes, sir. And I think even though there was a presentation, I think the Hanley firm and the Barron Budd through Paul Farrell presented at the County Attorneys Association. And then there was a second meeting of the County Commissioner Attorneys Association where there was, I think, a presentation in the last two or three weeks. And each time, I think it was just two law firms.
Okay, that's what I'm trying to get at. Because we got three.
Or two rooms.
I'll mention one other thing. As far as there were some questions about the DOJ and the DEA. There has been an order an order entered that Judge Polster said, work out giving the plaintiffs the ARCOS data for the nation so that we can know exactly who's been doing what to our counties, or I'll have a hearing and I'll order it. And our group is meeting with the DEA and the DOJ Thursday of this week. I believe that's correct. It's Thursday of this week. So it is moving very rapidly, the litigation, and I think once the ARCOS data is out there for the public to see exactly who's been doing what for how long, it may even be a catalyst.
One more thing I'm curious about, because I'm going to make a comment. I support what we're going to do here, but I'm also believing that the doctors are getting off too light.
Yes, sir.
Because they prescribe the stuff.
Yes, sir.
And I'm going to make a point here in a minute about something. And but our what's the American Medical say, even though they don't represent, but I think, 20% of the doctors, if I'm not mistaken, what is their take on all this, representing a body of doctors that do all these prescriptions?
Well, I know that they recently supported the decrease there is a cap at which opioids can be manufactured and distributed. That was just recently reduced by 20% by the DEA, and I think they were in support of that. In answer to your question about, first of all, there's enough blame to go around. There's no question about that. And we've got some pharmacies that probably have unclean hands as well. But to my way of looking at it, there were two types of physicians here. One is the dirty physician, who was, these pill mills that you hear about and taking cash and just, writing prescriptions, open their own little pharmacy out the back. And there were that type. But then there were also unwitting physicians. The manufacturers specifically marketed to dentists, and I can't tell you how many families I've had come up to me and tell me that they've either literally lost a child or figuratively lost a child because they went and got wisdom teeth pulled. And they had manufactured to these dentists knowing that they wouldn't know better. Now maybe they should have. And that's one of the education, part of the education model in our damage model, is an education of the physicians. Because everyone was duped to a certain degree, and they probably shouldn't have been, but I think there were some that weren't bad, that weren't intending to do harm, but ended up doing harm. So, anything else? All right, thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I may say one thing. I know that Clyde has got a resolution before you, but yeah. One thing, at least our group, we are including in there, as Amy has said, is the abatement of a public nuisance. And just felt like that if we're going to go litigate, then you need to have all the issues that you can, that you would want to pursue. And and so in your resolution, I hope that that would be considered.
Mr. Daniel, is your proposed resolution based on your work with all these other counties and things that have been done and them retaining your law firm?
Yes, ma'am. The resolutions that have been passed in all of these other 24 to 25 counties are pretty much the resolution that y'all have had from the very outset several months ago. And then each time I think I've come and I brought a copy of that with some tweaking.
Right. And then Mr. Albright, I think, has added data in it specific to Alamance County.
Right. And I didn't ask the board to approve that tonight for a reason. You've got a lot of information that you have to consider. I would suggest that you read the packets. If you have any further questions, you can give them to me. I can give them to the firms. And then we can hire a firm and then sit down with that firm in closed session and decide exactly what you want to put in that resolution. I would suggest that would be the best way to do it. And then that way, whatever law firm gets hired, they can tell you what they believe the claim should be. And we can proceed in that fashion.
So we don't need a resolution to pursue.
I put that forward tonight to let you know that there are some facts that are specific to Alamance County. We do not have thousands of people addicted to opioids. We're a small county. We do have some damages. We have some damages. But what I'm saying is I don't have enough information at this point to tell you what claims should be made. These are the experts. These are the guys that have been in the litigation, national litigation. What I hope to achieve tonight is to give you enough information from these firms that you can make a decision as to which firm you want. And they're all good. They're all good firms.
I have a question. Go ahead, Bobby.
So you're not going to make a recommendation? I don't mean tonight.
Well, I feel like the board
as our staff attorney.
Yeah, I feel like the board needs to take a very close look at this. I hesitated to have you do any type of resolution at our last meeting because I hadn't talked to DSS or the health department.
Well, let me ask about the resolution. So a resolution has a lot of whereas clauses.
Yes.
Well, those aren't binding. Whereas clauses aren't particularly binding, are they? They're just providing background, but
right.
That's not to say that that's what our claim damages are going to be.
And that's the point I'm trying to make. That is, as a governing body, you gather the facts from your experts, the health director, the DSS director, the sheriff's department, the EMS folks, and you're saying there is a problem here, and here, quantitatively, this is what we see. We see 19 people dying. We see so many children go to foster care. This is how much we spent last year.
Yeah, but that has nothing to do with how we proceed legally.
You turn to the experts that can tell you.
So why leave that stuff out of the resolution?
Well, those elements that go in the complaint, I can't tell you what the elements are for public nuisance. These guys can't. That's why I'm saying that don't put that in your resolution. And I think if you hire, once we hire a firm and they sit down with us in closed session, they can explain that in greater detail. But I couldn't go into closed session because we don't have an outside attorney hired yet. And we haven't noticed a closed session on our agenda.
I have a little bit of a technical trending question. Orange County has the NICU. We don't have a NICU in Alamance County.
Yeah, we have almost a NICU.
So if we have babies that are born in Alamance County who have a severe addiction, who need special treatment, and they're sent over to Orange County, for purposes of computing damages, do they get counted in Orange County, or do they get counted by residents?
Susan, do you know the answer to that?
Are we gonna get less damages because our legitimate problems for children who are disabled are being treated in other places? How are those people counted?
No. So if that child needed to come into foster care, it would be Alamance County's case. If the treatment for the CC4C, it would be Alamance County's.
It's based on your county
and
residents.
And it's amazing, Madam Chairman, that same question was raised in Orange County when we presented it.
Because they had to say it.
Like Commissioner said, that same question. What
That's
I would
hilarious.
Like to leave you with is a copy of the resolution that we had prepared earlier, but I took what Clyde had put all of his findings, whereas in that and for y'all.
So are we going to pass the resolution tonight? Do you need a resolution?
No.
We're not going to do anything tonight. So all of this was for information.
I wanted to make sure you got information. All of these folks responded to our requests for information, and they provided a lot of it. And it's a lot to digest. It's a lot to take in.
I'm confused. How do we hire an attorney firm to represent us, and we hadn't said we need an attorney firm? Isn't that what the resolution does?
That's what I thought. It was to authorize Clyde to...
Yes, but before you can authorize me to hire a firm, we have to know which firm it's going to be. See, yeah. And that's why I put it in that format, so you can have this information before you, hear from the parties, and make a decision. You don't have to make that decision tonight, but that's best made in closed session.
Now, Guilford and Forsyth just approved theirs, right?
They did.
What is the difference in those two, as far as you know? I know they went with your firm, but...
Yes. Paul?
Difference as it relates to the resolution?
Well, and linked into Clyde's theory here.
Well, Forsyth passed a resolution declaring there's a nuisance. Guilford is going to do it a little bit differently. They're going to do it in the complaint and not in the resolution.
Have you looked at those?
Well, Guilford's attorney and I think on the same way. We feel like it's best left in the complaint. Somebody knows what they're doing. I don't have that much experience in federal litigation. These folks do. They've been at this case for a couple of years.
Yes.
And so that's the best way to get the complaint drafted. Somebody knows what to put in there.
Just to answer the question, I know some counties have decided to do a resolution. Some have not. I know Mecklenburg, for example, did not want to do a resolution, and that is mainly because to declare a public nuisance, they really felt like they would have had to have a lot of education to do that first in a resolution. And so that was at least their thinking. I think Mr. Albright's entirely right. That's a decision that can be made if you want to go the route of having a resolution that declares a public nuisance. You certainly can do that, but you also don't have to do that to bring a common law public nuisance claim, which is, for example, what Mecklenburg, probably it sounds like Guilford, decided to do.
I would commend Mr. Albright. The facts he put in that resolution are pretty good to say we've got a problem. That's what a nuisance is.
But the heading of the resolution is the resolution to decide to sue. To proceed, I believe the heading is to proceed with litigation.
Well, what this resolution said, if we were going to vote on it, was that we recognize there's a problem and that we would authorize you
right
to engage in direct outside counsel to pursue legal action.
Right.
So, but you don't want to do that.
Well, I do, after you've had a chance to review the presentations and decide which outside firm you want to go with.
But we can do the resolution without deciding that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Well, you can.
I so move that we do it.
Is there a reason we shouldn't do that? I mean, is it putting us in some sort of jeopardy?
I'm not going to draft a complaint. What I'm going to do is pass that resolution in that form, then I'll talk to the board and get some direction as to which firm you decide you want to engage.
Okay, I'm a little unclear. Which resolution is the subject of your motion, Mr. Sutton?
Look, I'm not a lawyer. I should have been. I just think we need to proceed.
Right.
And I can't believe that we're the only county around that hasn't got enough information to proceed, that we want to do something legal or we don't. So, you know, put that in any language you want to. I just think waiting another meeting is needless.
I tend to agree.
Does that make any sense?
The time is of the essence. I mean, we've heard that 2018 is the year for this. But I am a little unclear about whether or not we're making a motion to, on the resolution to pursue legal action that was presented by Mr. Daniel, or if it's the one that was presented by Mr. Albright.
Well, the one is in the packet. The one is on the agenda is the one I prepared.
Right.
What was the one you sent out, a revised one recently?
I think that's what this is, isn't it?
That was my fault this morning with my inability to master our new computer system.
All right.
I sent you one that drafted on February the 14th, and the health director and the DSS director said, "What are you, crazy? This is not the one you want." And so I had to send you the
I would say that the one from Mr. Albright says that Alamance County Attorney is authorized to engage and direct outside counsel to pursue legal action. So I think that this resolution would give that choice to Mr. Albright and not to the board, which is not what I would be in favor of. I think
well,
that's
like
the board's
decision.
I think
he's going to do what we tell him to do.
That's right. I'll take direction from the board. Mm-hmm. I work for you.
I just want to get down the road
yeah,
with this.
Let's get it on the
doctor. Okay, there's a motion on the table.
That's
we
right.
Need to
well, there's a motion and a second.
I'll call for the motion, call for the question.
So, well, I just want to be sure that we're voting.
Okay.
We know what we're
yes.
voting on.
Okay.
So, we're voting on the motion as drafted by Mr. Albright and in the agenda packet.
Yeah.
That's what I understand we're doing.
Okay, great.
And if the vote passes, we can still pick whichever firm we want, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. That's
the deal.
Where we're going. Yeah.
All right. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great.
Now, before, may I say something, what I got to say, please?
Of course.
I know when I brought this up, the tone in here and elsewhere was, there he goes again. I've been on a I'm not ashamed of it. Everything is linked. Opioids, doctors, systems that push drugs, so forth and so on. I've been on a kick for 5 years about ADHD. A lot of people don't want to hear it. And I made a comment in here that they're going to have this opioid meeting. And I made the comment, well, please get somebody to answer some questions about, for instance, all these opioid people, what was the first drug they took? What, how old were they? So forth and so on. Yes, I was trying to show that there was a link, maybe inadvertently, or I don't know, was it the same majority? But it's just like everything. One drug leads to another. One dependency leads to another. Now, I want to read you something. This doesn't mean I'm right, but by George, it doesn't mean I'm wrong. This was written in Psychology Today back in June, end of June 2017, by Joel Young, who's medical director, or a doctor at, scroll down here, teaches psychiatry at Wayne State University and is the medical director the Rochester Center for Behavioral Medicine. Here's what he wrote. He's talking about opioids. The title of the article was ADHD and Opioid Addiction. Tim Sutton didn't write this. Bob?
I read the article. It was
oh, you've read it.
Pretty, yeah,
well, good.
Thank you for sending it.
But we're letting a lot of people off the hook here. Says every day, this is the second paragraph, said every day more than 1,000 people are treated in emergency rooms for opioid-related accidents and side effects. Second sentence, people with ADHD are disproportionately represented among their ranks. That's no mere coincidence. ADHD is a significant risk factor for addiction and in particular for addiction to opioids. It's all linked together, in my opinion. You give drugs to people that need them, and you give drugs to people who don't need them. And then you wonder why you got a problem. I hope someday we can wake up and figure out we don't need to be giving drugs to infants. I had Dr. Connors come to this community years ago who founded the ADHD clinic at Duke. He is introduced worldwide as the father of ADHD. He was involved with the experiments that led to Ritalin usage. He believes there's ADHD. But not at 15%, not at 10%. He thinks the legitimate rate in this country, in this state, should be 2-3%. It was at 15% when I first started talking about this. Everybody thinks I'm crazy. But when you start pushing parents to take their children to a doctor just because they won't sit still, they're fidgety, or they're not making A's as Joey is. And then you wonder, decades later, why you got other problems. I'm not saying it's totally linked, but by George, I think there's a good link there. And I guarantee you, if Dr. Connors were still alive, he died this past July. As a matter of fact, he died right before that article was written. 80-some years old. But I guarantee you, Dr. Connors would tell you that there's a big link between any medicine that we give people, and whether it be an opioid or ADHD or something else. But I hope we can get to the bottom of this and find out who's the... I go to doctors. They run from me.
Me too.
I'm serious. I'm not ashamed to tell you, we had a pediatrician on the school board. I approached her out in the parking lot. Everything was very nice until I started asking her questions like this. And she ran from me. They're serving the public, I believe. They're serving the patients, they believe. But I know this isn't what we're here for tonight, but I have to speak out on it. It is late. And a minimal way, if not more so. And that's a pretty good article by a credible young man, or I'm not sure how old he is. He definitely thinks there's a link, and when he says there's a disproportionate involvement of the opioid people to ADHD from earlier contact, and we don't talk about it, we don't discuss it, we're afraid to debate it in this community and elsewhere, I got it. It's heavy on my heart. You know, we see so many issues out there that there are answers to,
right,
yet we won't do it. It's better to get the opioids than not. But I tell you one thing, it's better to go after everything that we can, but maybe not with y'all, but in this effort here. But we got a problem in this country and in this world.
Well,
turning our backs on things that we ought to face head up. And I'm sorry I get to ranting here.
And they lead to other things, don't
they? Oh, of course they do.
They do, and thank you for those comments, Mr. Sutton. And I think that there's not a person in this room whose life hasn't been touched somehow by this opioid epidemic. My daughter is 21 years old. She's a junior at Carolina, and so she graduated from Western Alamance High School in the class of 2015. And at the end of January, someone who was in her class, a 20-year-old young lady, died of an overdose from heroin.
Wow.
And this is, you know, I don't want to betray that family's confidence or talk about them and increase their pain somehow. But the opioid situation is desperate, and it is terrible.
And it's real.
And it is real, and it's here, and our children are suffering in so many ways. Our community is sick from the overdose, or from the overprescription of these medications. And it's really incumbent on all of us to do everything that we can to try to address that. So,
tongue in cheek, remember the Rolling Stones song that dealt with pills?
I remember the Lynyrd Skynyrd one.
She's not that old. She's not that old, Tim.
Mother's Little Helper?
Yes.
I do.
That goes way back.
I love the Rolling Stones.
Okay. So I think that's it for that agenda item. So we'll move on to discussing.
Madam Chairman.
Oh, yes, sir.
A question while you're still on that a little bit.
Sure, Mr. Boney.
Could you outline what the plan is for the commissioners in terms of selecting one of the three law firms?
I believe from my understanding that we're going to go into, at our next meeting, the first meeting in March, that we will go into a closed session to discuss which law firm we're going to hire.
After we review
the materials that have been provided by the law firms. That is my understanding from the discussion tonight.
Madam Chairman, I just raise a little bit of question about that. I've had an opportunity only to talk partially with your attorney earlier. My understanding is you would be hiring them, in essence, as an independent contractor representing the board. As such, I really don't see that there is necessarily closed session material for legitimate material for a closed session. Closed session is supposed to be with respect to consulting with an attorney hired by the board. I do appreciate the way he described to you, which I think is absolutely accurate, that in the future, whenever you decide on one of the three, that y'all may meet in a closed session. But one of the early comments troubled me when there was a suggestion that you might do that as part of the selection process. There is no authority to do that. But he's made clear that's not a part of it. But I just question why the board wouldn't just decide. You've heard the three presentations. Not pushing you to do it tonight. It's not, I don't mean to say I don't care, but I do not have a an opinion with respect to the time frame. I do have an opinion with respect to a great preference that it be done openly. And to be honest, all the more, just to be sure that everybody's treated above board. We've been very forthright in outlining a potential perceived conflict, perhaps. But I just think the board has the information, coupled with what was presented, coupled within the packet. I don't know why anything else would need to be enclosed. But in particular, I want to be sure that you don't meet with any of these three in closed session before you have selected one of them.
Right. Well, Mr. Albright?
Yeah, we would be able to meet, though, after we've selected them.
The board instructs me on which firm. I'll invite them after we've hired them to closed session, and we'll work on the basics of getting started with
because we need to outline.
But I think part of my concern, Madam Chairman, is the description that y'all are going to sort of instruct Mr. Albright. If that's sort of a instruction that's take place between now and the next meeting, I would have great concerns. I think the five of y'all individually talking to Mr. Albright about which one you prefer, I think is a very questionable compliance with the open meetings law. I think it is more properly addressed in the open, whether it's at this meeting or next one or down the road, but to be out in the open, we want this firm for whatever reason, and frankly, you don't necessarily have to give a reason. It's clear what some of the reasoning might be just from their own presentations, but my concern is that there not be this interim time in which that there are individual discussions going on or even amongst you about which firm.
Right. Well, Mr. Albright, what do you have a response to that?
Well, I think we put it on the agenda for our next meeting. Decisions made in open session. We'll go in a closed session with that firm.
Okay. So we will decide. We'll make the selection in open session. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Great. Good clarification. Okay. Cronodal building sale. Mr. Haygood.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. So I'd originally meant to speak to you this evening about the offer that you had on the table from Alamance Academy about the purchase of the Cronodal building property, and I prepared a presentation. Madam Chair, would you like for me to go ahead and go through that presentation for the board's benefit?
I think
it's
if the offer has been withdrawn, then we don't need to take up time talking about things that are specific to that offer. But I think it would be appropriate to update the board and especially the public on the condition of the building and the appraised value. And what do we know about that building that we didn't know 60 days ago?
Certainly. Let me pass out a map here for each one of you. And have a very brief presentation to go through with you. Give you some information about the building. So originally I had asked the board to table the decision for 60 days. That request was made by me.
Who?
And my hope was that during that time period, we would be able to select a firm to come in, do our overall facility plan for all of our properties, and my desire was to make sure the Cronodal building was one of the first things tackled. I will say it has taken us longer to select a firm than I had originally thought. We are soliciting firms now via the county's website, and I believe we're putting an ad in the paper. We will not have a selection of the firm to do our entire plan. It's not just about Cronodal building, it's about all county properties. We won't have that selection made until late March or possibly early April. And if the timetable we have laid out for that plan, if it stays in place, will be complete in September of this year. So what I thought I would do is give you some information that I would also provide to planners. I know this is hard for folks in the audience to see, but you have before you a map of our what I call East Burlington campus. And if you look on the map, you can see the Cronodal building. It's highlighted over there on the left-hand side of the property. If you look around, all the call-outs that you see, within a two-block radius of this property, we have 10 county buildings. Approximately 40% of our full-time employees work in this area. We have a very large footprint in this area. We have 10 buildings, not counting the Cronodal building. The Cronodal would be the 11th. If you look at the conditions of the building, so the information you'll see for each building on the call out is the name of the building, the year it was built, how many square feet it has, and also its letter grade. If you remember a couple years ago, the county facilities staff went through and assigned letter grades to buildings to try to help us get a better idea of what condition are these buildings in. 5 of these 10 buildings that are in the same proximity as the Cronodal site are either grade C or D. These are, without doubt, the buildings that we have in the worst shape and of all of our county inventory. So you can see that from my perspective, the Cronodal property lends itself to possibly be a solution for some of these problems that we have. You know, my desire was to get a planning firm in here to help us figure out what that solution might actually be, but I can tell you by just looking what's around it and our footprint that close, where the property may not have much monetary value, I think it may have significant value from a county building planning perspective. And I'd like for us to take that opportunity to give some consideration to it. And as you know, we presented you with a plan we did with Mosier Meyer back in, I believe, 2015, where we looked at the Cronodal building and came up with about 4 options of possible use for the property. The first option in the plan, I didn't bring the plan again tonight. You have it. Just a brief synopsis of what that plan said. The firm laid out 4 options for us, one which was to demolish the building and only improve the property for its parking value, which was going to cost a little over $500,000. Another option the firm laid out was to demolish half of the building and fully renovate the other half, which was going to cost about $2.4 million. Option 3 was a full renovation of the entire property, which cost a little over $3.5 million, which we do not, at that time, I had asked the firm to hold the cost of what we had realized from the sale of the Peak property. So option 3 actually put us a little bit over what we had realized from the Peak property, but that's a pretty good estimate. And then option 4 for the property was to demolish the property, do the bare minimum level of improvements, and then put out RFPs or RFQs for could there be a public-private partnership on this property where the county maintains ownership of the land, maybe there's a private facility built on it for some use, maybe folks are leasing space, maybe the county's leasing space, we didn't know. Bottom line, on all of these options that we looked at, new construction was possible on all of them except for option number 3. Option number 3, if you renovate that entire building, the parking capacity is about all we've got. We wouldn't build anything else. But the rest of them, we figured if you tore down the building, it may be a couple of years, it may be in time, but you could always build something back there if it's just being used for parking. Same thing with the half renovation. So in the meantime, since we last talked about the Cronodal property, we did get an appraisal done of the building. The total value was appraised to be $255,000. The appraisal indicated that the building has no contributory value. I will say the building has deteriorated significantly since we took ownership of it and is in poor shape, and we're going to have to make a decision about that in the near future regardless. The cost to demo the building was estimated by the appraiser at $70,000. I'll tell you that that probably did not include the asbestos abatement that we will be required to do when we abate it or if we renovate it. But our closer cost from the Mosier Meyer look was about $125,000 to totally demo it and properly abate the asbestos. So the final estimate of the property value by the appraiser was $185,000. But indeed, it's more like around $135,000 once you take into account what it would cost us to take the building down if that's what we decided to do. Oops, a little too far. So what I was hoping to be able to demonstrate to you this evening was not to downplay the proposed use of by Alamance Academy. I think that the service they provide is very valuable, and I hate that Ms. Peterson is gone, because I would apologize to her that this has felt to her as a long and drawn out process. My only desire was to ensure we gave a good thorough look at this property before we parted with it to make sure it was something that we felt like we did or did not need. Unfortunately, we couldn't do that with a planning firm, but I do feel that the best thing to do has probably happened. Ms. Peterson has withdrawn her desire to buy the property. We'll retain the property through this planning process, and we'll be looking at each one of these buildings and seeing how does this property possibly benefit us for long-term facility needs for the county. I don't know what a department, when we did the Mosier Meyer study, I didn't really have a lot of ideas about what departments might be involved. I think that's something our plan process will tell us. You know, we We could possibly use the Carnoval site for new construction, designed specifically for the use that we come up with, what departments are going to be in there, and actually design the building in that way. Or we could renovate the existing property. I don't know. Or we could go through this planning process and find that we have no use for this property at all, that there may be a adequate room on one of these other properties you see, because there is open space on them too. It may be better to construct somewhere else. We have open space at the Human Services Center property, as well as down on Martin Street. We have some open area there too. So I think we're at a point where the bid has been withdrawn. My plan now is to proceed through the planning process for this property, come up with a use that's in context with all of this issue, all of this area, as well as the Graham campus that we have, and bring that back to you in September and present it to you, and hopefully we'll adopt it, and that'll be the way we'll go from here on out. So I'm happy to try to answer any questions if you have.
How big is that lot that's on?
It's a little over 2 acres. It's almost 2.25 acres.
2.43 acres.
That's really a nice location.
Mm-hmm. And if we did take it down, we could possibly build up too, and maintain that parking area.
Yes, that was one of the suggestions from Mosher Myers, that you could go multiple stories, and
which,
you know, maybe
cheaper in the long run.
What did they? You know, I've got that report, but what did they recommend? Not recommend, but what did they show was the that type of potential for that?
They put different maps inside the report that demonstrated what could possibly go on the footprint of the existing site. The existing site is almost 30,000 square feet. So one that I can remember off the top of my head was, if you demolished approximately half the building, you might could come back with a new construction that was 15,000 square feet, maybe two stories, so you get a total of 30,000. Yes. So I think you'd be looking at, if you built on the footprint, you might could build 60,000 square feet possibly if you went two stories. But the main thing I want to convey is I don't know what the final answer is for this property. I think going through the planning process will help us, but I wanted to be sure the board and the folks, public, understands that we have a huge footprint here, a significant county presence, and I think it really will benefit us to take a look at this property. And as Ms. Peterson mentioned, Cone Health has worked to put together a group of nonprofits and the county and the city of Burlington that are meeting, are going to start meeting regularly. We've had one meeting, and talk about our plan in context with all these other services that are going on in this area. And I think that's a very wise thing to do. There are a number of nonprofits here, PAYC, Charles Drew. There are a lot of services being provided in this area besides just by county government, and they're interested in what we're doing, and we want to make sure they're a part of our process, including Alamance Academy and Ms. Peterson.
Well, and part of that planning, that discussion would involve the old Western Electric plant too.
Yes.
Possibly.
Yes, the city is applying for a grant take a look at the old Western Electric plant and see how it might also factor into all this that we're talking about with nonprofit use, local government use, what private use could possibly be seen in the Western Electric site.
I think it's worthwhile saying that when that Phoenix Mosher Mayor study was done, that was at the time when we had to give up. I mean, I wasn't on the board then, but we had to find a place to relocate all the people that were on.
That's relocated out up here.
And so, there was a good potential use for that building to help to accommodate space needs during that time of transition.
Yes.
Well, and also, like environmental health, that building is terrible.
Yes, that's
one
of our...
going to happen over there, you know?
That's one of our D-rated buildings, and, you know, that will be... Actually, we're ready for this plan to be done because we have a number of repairs that environmental health needs, but we're somewhat reluctant to make those repairs if we're not going to be in that property for the long term. So
that's why we needed to have this comprehensive plan done. Mm-hmm. I mean, it should have been done a long time
ago.
Right, to
figure out how to maybe group.
And to help inform decisions about whether or not a building is worth investing more money in when something happens. You know.
So there's no action, I suppose, at this time. Just update for the board.
I had one question. Yes. Isn't it true that the Red Street side of the Old County Hospital, the Human Services Center, there's problems with vandalism of those cars that are kept back there? Isn't that right?
Yes.
The health department and Department of Social Services has problems with their vehicles being vandalized. I think one was set on fire.
Yes,
right?
That's correct.
So if we did use the old Kernodle building for parking, that would be a lot more visible.
Yes.
To law enforcement traveling by and the public traveling by, maybe less vulnerable.
And that is a excellent use of the property. No matter what happens to the building, the lot will take some improvement, and we would need to work with the city about making improvements to the Graham Hopedale Road street crossing to make sure public or employees, maybe a traffic island and proper signage and crosswalk and all those kind of things. But yes, I think the folks that work at DSS will probably agree that parking's at a premium at that location, and we want to make sure that the parking is as safe as possible.
Has ACTA moved any on where they may relocate, whatever?
I think they've sent a copy of a possible lease that we've shared with Mr. Albright, and he's in the process of reviewing
it. I'm reviewing that lease. That's over at Stanley Drive, where the old John Deere facility used to be. Yes.
Where we're storing some.
Right.
It could work out well for ACTA.
Yes, I think that. I think the site is much more secure.
Yeah.
And they're able to, the entire lot is fenced, and right. ACT is very interested in it. And we've met with Ralph several times to talk about how to facilitate it. So,
I know it was talking one time about over in that area, wasn't it? Using maybe the elderly service building?
Well, we've been talking about using that building for the Diversion and Restoration Center for the mm-hmm. Stepping Up Initiative.
Oh, okay.
And we took a tour of that with RHA, which is the comprehensive mental health provider, because they'd be the ones actually providing the crisis services. So they'd have to be able to move their whole agency into that building, and it looks like it would work out really well.
That's good.
And have some space left over for some wraparound services.
So we may
services.
Look good. At upgrading that building or yeah. pushing some money
yeah,
into that.
Yeah, that was, I mean, what's on the table is possibly using the Cardinal grant that we're getting to pay for that outfit.
Okay.
And it would be ideal to do all of this in the context of a larger plan where we know where we're moving folks and what buildings are going to be in play for the future. So.
Okay. Do any of the commissioners want to, I know Mr. Byrd, you had said that you had some remarks about the Alamance Academy proposal. Do you want to address that now, or do you want to save it for commissioner comments at the end of the meeting?
No, I'm not sure that they're relevant anymore.
Okay.
With the withdrawal.
All right.
Other than the fact that what I was going to say is that we have had precedents where we have essentially given away property that the county owned that was already being occupied by nonprofit organizations. And I mean, so I wasn't going to have a big problem with that if that's what we decided to do. For the $10,000, in other words, but it's all right.
Well, you know, I want to say this, and I think it's going to surprise some of you. Can I share the conversation I had with you today?
Sure.
Please. I got accused of being the instigator behind this, and I honestly believe that was couldn't have been more far-fetched. It was a business decision to proceed differently, business of this board to proceed differently. But I called Brian today because I got your memo about the appraisals and so forth and so on this weekend. So I thought, okay, I thought Brian was going to possibly, county manager was going to possibly say we've exhausted everything that we can exhaust in a business-like fashion. And I was willing to, and I told Brian, I said, don't tell me what you're going to do. Let me tell you what my feelings are. But I was going under the assumption that he wasn't going to, that he was going to possibly say, let's go ahead and, you know, get it out from under us. So I called him. And I said, you know, if that's what we're going to do, I'm willing to support her, give it to her. Because we've exhausted every possible business-like fashion to investigate this to the best of our ability, to put it to its best use. and to meet the requirements that it was given to us under, you know, community service. And I'm not trying to hang Brian with this at all, but, you know, Brian was sticking to his guns, saying he believed this was the best thing to do right here. I mean, what you're saying right here is it wasn't changed because of what she did. It was coming anyway. And I have a sneaking suspicion she knew it. Possibly. Why do what she did? But I was willing to guide it. I mean, I wasn't trying to keep it from her, but I wasn't willing to jump on it passionately or philosophically or emotionally. I was going to look at it in a fashion of what was the best thing to do for Alamance County. And so, once again, I think I was labeled in an improper fashion, which is not unusual. But I stuck to my guns. Brian stuck to his, as far as a good business county manager. And I don't think, you know, Brian's going to be perceived as being anti-her, as I was. But it's sad that sometimes in government and also in these type of forums that you do get some darts thrown at you that you don't deserve. But I wasn't opposed to doing what she was putting out there, short of a whole lot more of introspection on our part. And yes, I still stick to saying you give somebody that property that's worth what we say is worth, $10,000, without a whole lot of proof that we can't do any better. And we just didn't have that proof.
Well, I would say I do regret that we don't have a plan that I can lay out before you, especially for Ms. Peterson's benefit, that we say with definitively what we're going to do with the property. I hate that we don't have that. I do think the right thing to do is to take the opportunity to look at it that way. And I'm also encouraged by this group that is meeting at Cone's instigation to talk about what's the nonprofit role over here. And I think it's entirely possible that Alamance Academy may find a home over here in this area in the long run. And in fact, I'm not to say that it won't be the Cronodal property. I think our plan will define that. But again, I do want to be sure that Ms. Peterson and the folks at Alamance Academy know that I recognize that they feel like they have kind of been strung along a little bit. I apologize for that. And it was never my intent or the board's, I'm sure.
No,
I don't think so.
I think we're moving forward in the right way.
Indeed.
Well, let me say, now we're talking about this, I ran, as I'm always going to do, the right thing for the people who pay the taxes, and I'm sticking to that. I don't care who it makes mad. I am not going to give anything away. It's going to cost the taxpayers, period.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Haygood. Next on the agenda is the approval to apply for the Abandoned Manufactured Home Removal Grant Program. And Libby Hodges.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm here to ask your permission to apply for the Abandoned Manufactured Home Removal Grant from the North Carolina Department of Environmental Quality. I have to get that name right now. We've run this program since 2013.
And it's been a good one, too.
It's been a great
one. Sure been a good one.
We have removed about 53 single-wide manufactured homes. Four double wides. I've gotten a lot of area cleaned up. We would be going again, since we're a repeat applicant, it would be a $10,000 grant.
I move approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. All right, tax liens and delinquent accounts, Mr. Akins.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Commissioners. It is that time once again. The general statutes in 105-369A call for the tax collector to come before the governing body and report the total amount of unpaid taxes that are liens on real property. Upon receipt of that report, the governing body then orders the tax collector to publish each lien at least once in a newspaper having general circulation within the county. Now, as of January 31st, 2018, the total amount of liens against real property for current year taxes was $218,683.67. That's the number in the packet. I was curious how we're doing today, so I went ahead and looked before I came up here, and we've got that amount down to $2,870,339.56. So as you can see, we're working, trying to whittle that down, get that brought as low as we can. We want to make sure that our citizens have plenty of time to come in and pay before we advertise, so we're recommending advertisement on or about March 22nd. That gives them through the end of the month, even with postmarks, and you know, sometimes we'll get delays. It'll be a week or two out, and you'll get that odd piece of mail. That way we know if you pay by the end of the month, there won't be an advertisement for that person. For the folks that don't, when we put that in the newspaper, the cost is borne by the person advertised. So there's a $5 fee added to the account. That way the taxpaying citizen that pays timely is not paying for the advertisement of the citizen that was not timely. What I'm here to request is that the board make a motion that any delinquent accounts be advertised and the $5 fee be applied.
Do we need to, that as a motion?
Yes.
So moved.
Second.
Anybody? Any discussion?
I just want to know what happened to our old tax administrator.
I know. We lost part of him.
Thank you.
Only half of him is still around.
Hopefully the best half.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, economic development incentive policy, the amendment with Mr. Hagwood.
Thank you, Commissioners. You have in your packet a revised economic development incentive policy that is based on changes that the board discussed and voted to approve at the February 5th meeting. The only change to the policy that you have is found in paragraph 6. It's a new paragraph that we have added. And the paragraph reads as such: a press release shall be issued to the press no later than 12 o'clock noon, 7 days prior to the public hearing date. The press release must identify the entity, the proposed amount of taxable investment, the proposed number of new full-time jobs, the proposed wage rates, any jobs retained in Alamance County as a result of the project, and the proposed number of temporary jobs created by the project. Now, for the purposes of this policy, our intent is to interpret temporary job numbers to be limited to the project that is being considered, not to the global company footprint. So when we ask the company to give us the number of temporary jobs that they're going to have at the facility or at the expansion, that's what we'll be expecting to receive. So I want to make sure that we're all on the same page with that.
I understand the global part, but now, you know, what they're doing, like, for instance, Honda, 40%. I almost fell out of my chair when I heard it, 40 to 45. I'm not really as interested in, well, I am interested in what degree the new jobs are going to be temporary, but I'm also interested in what degree they use temporaries now.
So the existing company's temporary job numbers and the...
Yeah, the question I asked Honda, they were going to offer no jobs. Yeah, but if it had been 5 jobs, I still would have asked the same question. What percentage of temporaries do you use right now?
I believe in Alamance County or at the facility where the incentive is being considered.
Yeah,
your question.
I understand.
Not just the new jobs, but what do they do in this county now?
At the company in Alamance County, what's their percentage of temporary jobs? Either that's existing number of jobs in Alamance County and or the new jobs that they would be bringing. Okay.
Inclusive of the new jobs.
I believe the language can stay the same. We will interpret it that way when we pose those questions to the company. Also,
can I just say one thing? We just have to be careful how we interpret that information. The answer to that specific question may not provide enough information to get at what you're getting at. Because I think, you know, we all want to see full-time jobs that pay benefits and health insurance and all that. But that's not the business model of most companies. Now, maybe they don't have 40%. And there are some employers, like where I used to work, we used a lot of temp agencies because that was the only way we could get skilled people.
Yeah.
And so if you didn't know that, and you know, and you just basing your decision
nice
on
know.
The answer to that question that as you're posing, you might
it's better to know something than nothing.
Yeah.
And you know, I think it's an abused process like crazy, and I want to know about it I'm not gonna vote for cash and sins anyway, but you know, I think we need to know.
There were two other points that I wanted to just indicate are not in this language that we talked about a little bit on the at the February 5th meeting. We did not include the word benefits in full-time jobs. We only asked full-time jobs. We talked about it internally and thought it may be very difficult to define what the, you know, what the benefits are. You know, there's a lot of different ways to define benefits. That would make it difficult for us to verify. We can verify the jobs that have been created, but we felt like if we put that in here and actually said, you will tell us the benefits, it might be difficult for us to figure out, did they meet the terms or not? So we did leave that out. And the other term that was suggested by a couple members of the public was, and we did not put this in either, about only having those public hearings at night. I understand the desire to have them at night. We would strive to do that. Talking with the chamber, it might restrict us a little bit when we can schedule them. Sometimes those are done in concert with our municipal partners. I understand that people may want to come, and it's easier for them to come in the evening. We will make every effort to schedule them in the evening, but we felt like if we put it in the policy, that could push us months out trying to find a good time to do it, and it may miss the window of opportunity. So,
well, I think by having this new language in there will educate the public to what's going on before they even have to come. So,
and I don't believe, Madam Chair, this requires a vote. If the commissioners feel like this change to the policy reflects your discussion and action at the February 5th meeting. So,
right, the county manager and I discussed that number six, and I thought that maybe some clarification was needed, so that's why we brought it forward to talk about it. So now we have that.
Yes.
Great. Thank you.
That will be our new policy.
And then the meeting, unless there's any more discussion about that, the meeting location change for the March 19th regular meeting.
So we're requesting that the Board of Commissioners consider moving their regularly scheduled meeting on March 19th from this room to the historic courthouse. That is the evening where Alamance Burlington School System and Alamance Community College will be coming to present their bond resolutions to the board. We expect there will be a significant number of folks in attendance, and would suggest that for their convenience, we move the meeting.
You want a motion?
It does.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you so much, Mr. Haygood.
Thank you.
Do you have a county manager's report for us tonight?
I do not.
Any commissioner comments?
I want to make just a couple. I'll try to be brief. Two things. One is that Cardinal Innovations Healthcare is making available a grant opportunity for its 20-county catchment area. They are requesting proposals. They're going to be granting a total of $3.8 million. And there's an application process. It needs to be, applicants either need to be a county, a municipal government, or how do they say it, a well-established organization, being a nonprofit, essentially a nonprofit organization, or a local school system, or a higher education institution. So I know this has been out there to a lot of, it's been published by the Community Council, United Way, and other organizations. I don't know if it's on our website, but I could give this to Tori, maybe send you the email to. And then the other thing is that the County Commissioners Association, our president, Brenda Howerton, Commissioner Howerton is from Durham County. You know, each president of the association during their term has a president's focus or initiative, and hers is called Thrive. It's helping all 100 counties help our children to thrive, and she has invited teams from each county to come to this a symposium that's going to be in Greensboro at the convention center. What's the name of it?
Curry.
Yeah, the Sheraton Greensboro Four Seasons. Yes, thank you. And on March 21st and 22nd. So I've already registered, but they're encouraging multiple commissioners and county manager and other staff to come. Maybe DSS, Health Department. That's it.
Great. Thank Anyone you. Else?
And Tori, I'll send you that email from the association.
All right. Well, if there's no further business before the board, then we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.